Grateful to be here. Did you bring your praise with you this morning? We came to give him praise. I'm so grateful to be here. I'm so happy to be here. I'm full, and I thank him for that. I thank him for the many blessings that he's already bestowed upon us, and we just gonna go into it. How many of y'all know that when you need help, who do you call on? Hey, that's who you call on. When you need help, you gotta know who to call on, and we gonna go right into it.
What's your worry?
my health. I like the way they keep going up and up and up, because it's like, you got to remember, let's tell yourself, Jesus is my help, not me. So you got to repeat it. I need to go up. Jesus is my help. Jesus is my, say it again. Jesus is my help. Say it again. Jesus is my help. You like, you don't think about yourself being your own help. Like, I got the resources. I can do. No, Jesus is your help. Any situation, whatever you're going through, Jesus is your help. So because he's our help and we know that, we're going to give him some praise and bless his name. We're going to bless him because we know that we can call on him. Bless the wonderful name of Jesus this morning.
We're going to clap your hands, y'all. Come on.
Yeah.
We're going to take it back. We're going to bless the Lord. We're going to take it back. We're going to bless the Lord. We'll be right back.
And then when you tell him thank you, you just got to remember all the ways that he's made for you. Don't sit there and be like, oh, I don't remember. Oh, yes, you do. Just think about yesterday. Think about today when he woke you up. Don't forget to tell him thank you. Don't forget to tell him thank you. It don't matter what's going on. You can still say thank you. He's worthy all the time. Not some of the time. And I'm going to give him my praise. I don't care what's going on. Woo! He's more than able to do exceedingly more than we can think or ask. He's more than able. Yes, he is.
How many know that God is able to do exceedingly, abundantly above all you can ask or think? Woo! According to the power that worketh in us.
Hallelujah. How many believe it tonight? Somebody turn to your neighbor and tell your neighbor, he's able. Tell somebody else, he's able. Y'all ready? Exceedingly, abundantly, above all you could ask. According to the power that worketh in you, God is able to do just what he said he would do. He's gonna every promise to you. Don't give up on God, 'cause he won't give up on you. He's able.
How many believe it tonight?
Yeah, yeah.
He's able.
Thank you, Jesus.
Come on, y'all, I need y'all to help me sing.
God is able to do just what he said
he would do.
He's
gonna fulfill.
He's gonna fulfill.
Here we go.
He's able.
let you know that he's able. Don't lose sight of the prize at this time. Don't lose sight. Don't think you can just be lackadaisical. Like, you got to stick with it. You got to stick in that word. You know what I'm saying? Don't let the ball drop at the 11th hour. Don't come all this way and think that he's not going to see it to the end. I'm so grateful. I just praise his name. He's able. Those finances, just say he's able. Put it on, say he's able. Your health, he's able. That business, he's able. Just tell it. Don't say I don't have, I wish I could get. Just look at it and say, he's able. I'm so glad this morning. I'm gonna praise him in everything. In everything, give thanks. And that's what we came to do this morning. My scripture is Psalms 107, verse 8 and 9. Oh, that men would praise the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. For he satisfieth the longing soul and filleth the hungry soul with goodness. Now, if that ain't enough, if you hungry? You hungry? Are you hungry? Praise his name so you can be filled. It's some, you know what I mean? It's directions is right here. It just tells us what to do. You don't have to walk around starving, and you don't have to walk around being hungry. You don't even have to be thirsty. He gave us everything in Jesus. All right. You will be filled. We're going to go into prayer right now. Hallelujah. Yes. Thank you.
Yes, I feel so much better.
Amen.
And I'm the one in the charge.
All right.
My heavenly Father. I love you, Jesus.
Yes, we do.
You love me first.
Yes.
Amen. Amen.
What a wonderful God.
Yeah. Wonderful. Yeah. 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 Worship. Worship you. Yes, we worship you. Yeah. Your name.
And all the people said,
Amen.
Amen, amen. Good morning, good morning, good morning. That's his name. I like that, sister. We didn't come this far to come this far.
That's real talk.
That's real talk. I like that. All right, it's testimony time, amen. Come up and express the goodness of God in your life so that we can join in with you. Amen.
Yes, sir. I just got to stand and give glory to God. As you guys know, my mom had surgery last week. Surgery was supposed to start at 9:30, but there was an issue with her potassium being too low, so everything started getting pushed back. Surgery didn't start. It was supposed to be starting at 9:30, about 4 hours. Surgery didn't start till closer to 1:30-ish. I wasn't concerned with the outcome because I was taught you take it to God, put it in prayer, and that's that. So from the time they said you have to have surgery, Lord, thank you for the surgery. I pray for the surgeon even now. And then I started praying for the surgeon's hands. And the reason I say that is because God will show you that he's got you. So at the start of the surgery, they were using a robot. I wasn't concerned with them using a robot because I already prayed for the surgery. But I prayed for the surgeon's hands, Lord. Can y'all explain to me why the surgeon took the robot and set it to the side and went hands-on and actually did the surgery with their own hands? I said, Lord, if you don't stop, you gonna get me to praising you a little bit more if you keep this up. So I am thankful that he answers prayer. Thank you for teaching me to be specific with prayer. It's not just throw it out there. You got to tell the Lord what you want. So I'm grateful. The surgery was a success. She's still in the hospital. She'll be home shortly. But I'm thankful and I'm grateful. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. I am just grateful, grateful, grateful. I am very thankful and I am so blessed to be here and to be able to come these past weeks and pray and not lose my faith and just stay with him, you know? That's the main thing, I think, to stay with him. Even though I wasn't able to be here, I was with him and I didn't have that before. And it's just a great learning and I'm so grateful because I got a new job and Yes, and I am so thankful because it was well needed. and I'm very, very grateful. I'm grateful because my son is turned 20, and that's a great blessing. I am just so blessed. I feel so blessed since I've been here with you guys. I have learned so much, and I think that main thing is that to stay with him, even though it could come, darkness could come, but he'll be the light, you know, and that's the best thing, you know, and not to feel alone. That doesn't exist because he's always with you, you know, so thank you, and I love you guys.
I thank the Lord this morning. I'm just thankful and grateful for his protection and for his kindness. Aaron's oldest son, we always said little Aaron, but he's 40. Aaron Jr. was hit by a DUI driver, totaled his car, and he walked away from it. And I know we could be a family grieving this morning. I realize that. The Lord didn't have to. Little Aaron is stubborn and he don't listen. And, you know, some lessons come hard when you don't listen and you debate and back and forth and somebody trying to tell you something to save your life, your mind, your soul, your spirit, and you debating, thinking you know everything. So I thank the Lord that beside all that, you know, we used to sing this song, he looked beyond my faults and saw my need. That's what he did for little Aaron. And I'm so thankful. Aaron is in Memphis right now, but he's going to Rockford, and he'll have a chance to talk to his son. And I'm just praying, he just seems unreachable. But I know that's when the Lord works at flood stage. Pastor Thurman taught us he works best at flood stage. And we don't want nothing else to happen to him for him to have to realize. You know, even in the accident wasn't even his fault. But there's so many other things in his life that he's faulty of. And we just want him to come to terms with all that. And I just want to tell the Lord thank you, though, for preserving his life. The woman was drunk and it just could have been a terrible, terrible thing. So I just want to say thank you. I thank the Lord for covering us. When we're praying, when Aaron is praying and clapping the trees and the ocean and all of that, the Lord is listening. And I just thank the Lord for helping him.
Good morning, saints. I just came up to just ask for a little extra prayer for me and my siblings. I lost my dad on the 26th. And, you know, it's like you always think you got time, you know? Like you talk, I mean, he didn't stay in Los Angeles, he in Fresno. He had been sick with a mouth cancer. And so sometimes it was hard to talk to him because he was in pain. But I knew he knew the Lord, and I know that he's in a better place. He's not in pain anymore. So I just asked, you know, because I have three other siblings, and the brothers, they're taking it, you know, where they're not really expressing that they're hurting. But, you know, I'm the oldest. And I can tell my brothers is hurting really bad. And I just ask the Lord to help me help them, you know, with their grieving, because I don't want them to harbor anything in which will affect them in their lives, you know, on just handling grief, you know. So it's like with me being in the medical field, sometimes I can handle it a lot better because I see and hear things all the time. So it's just, I just need guidance, you know, the spirit of the Lord. I mean, it's like I be around them. I can tell they're hurting, but I try to explain things in ways where they can feel better, you know? So I just ask everyone to just, you know, keep me in prayer and asking the Lord to continue to give me guidance on how to handle this situation. Thank you.
Good morning, saints. I'm so happy. My brother passed away a couple of weeks ago, and been quiet about it. But I know that he knew God. Even though he wasn't here, he knew God. He got saved on December the 23rd, the same time I got saved on December the 23rd. It was all well with me, you two, Rex, I know. Ain't about you. Love my brother, and I'm just grateful that God gives you peace in a storm. He holds you, he keeps your mind steady. And when someone passes away in your family, it's not easy to maneuver. But I thank God, I thank the saints for their prayers, and thank my pastor for helping me in some things. But I'm just grateful. My niece is here. My brother's daughter is here. That's my Patrice. She back there waving. Of course, she don't want to come up here. But I'm so grateful. When I seen her, I just lit up like a light bulb. Said, that's family. But God has been good to us and keeping us. I'm just grateful, Pastor. Nobody knows in life when they're going to go. We're all going to pass away somewhere in our life. But to make sure that you know God, that's the number one thing. Make sure you know God. Make sure you repent and give your life to God, and God takes over. I'm just grateful. It's just a privilege to be here. It's a privilege to be alive. Don't take anything for granted. Life can be short, but God is good. I praise his name. My heart is full of joy. I'm glad. I'm just glad. Thank you. I see you back there, Patrice. I just want to hold her here. I don't want her to go nowhere. I love you. And I thank you for taking care of the business of Bears back there. Appreciate you. Thank you.
Amen. Good morning, church. God help me. I'm worried about my brother. He had two heart attacks. And so he just laying there, so pray for him, please. Pray for him. I'll be praying for him every day, asking God to keep me up, keep me strong. I'm big brother. And my baby sister is on her way out here. Praise the Lord. Keep me in prayer. Amen.
God is so good. Shout, shout, let it all out. These are the things I can do. That's what I was hearing last week, too, when he's talking about shout. I know y'all think about the bottle and shouting out, but listen, shout it all out. That word right there, you ready to triumph? And shout it out? Shout that thing out. I heard Joyce Myers the other morning, woke up, and I'm like, you know, I've been talking about hearing and how you hear, and she was talking about that, and she was talking about how if you kind of decipher the radio station, if you pick and choose what you want to hear from God, eventually you'll stop hearing everything from God. And I said, bingo, the keto. Yes, that right there, that part. Man must not live by bread alone, but every word. And I said, see? And then Osteen was talking about suffering. And I'm like, man, and I can't get this thing out of my head. When Pastor was talking about that, somewhere along the line, you know, in your bloodline, or somebody set it up to be set up for you to be saved, they prayed for you. And I just think about all them little spread out from the beginning of when that thing started. And like, it ain't over as long as Jesus is on the throne. So it ain't over. Like Kristen was this morning, he's more than able. He's more than able. It's past the natural thinking. And I'm like, you know what? The apostle said, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. And I said, okay, I'm thinking about this. For me to live is Christ. But I have decided, Reverend Howlett, I'm going to die in faith. You know, this journey I've had setbacks because I believe to see certain things happen that didn't go my way, and you take setbacks in your faith. But the word says, fight the good fight of faith. It's a fight, but it's a good fight, and it's faith, and it's for a reason. That Hebrews 11 talking about those died in faith, having not seen the promises, but they believed to see them afar off, and that they got that peace and that joy that this is it. So I decided that's just going to be my stance, because he's more than able. So I ain't giving the devil the room to question God or and say, have God said? I'm dying in faith. That's what I have said in the name of Jesus. Whether I see it done or not, I believe he's more than able. And that's the only outcome that I am accepting from now on. He's more than able. We die in faith. I believe to see the healings. I believe to see the miracles. And that's just what it is. Devil, you a liar. Sometimes you can be under a certain attack and you may not know it. But the Spirit is faithful to bring it out. And you can bring that attack under the blood of Jesus and under subjection. And you got to step off. Get your hand out my pocket in the name of Jesus. Lord, teach me how to prosper. And in order for him to teach you how to prosper, you have to say, Lord, teach me how to give according to your standards. Because you don't have that in you naturally, he has to teach you how to give according to his standards. But I want to be right. I want to be whole. I ain't trying to talk. I'm talking about dying in faith. Because I want to see some things. But I'm still expecting to see some things. I'm not expecting to leave up out of here not seeing none of that. What I've been asking for and what we are believing. I'm expecting to see some things. Like I expect, I see we got our daughter Patrice in the house. Yeah, she'll be back. I'm expecting to see some things. Can these dry bones live? We're expecting to see some things. My heart is fixed, my mind made up. It's a fight, it's a good fight, but we are victorious in that fight. It's things we got to do to align yourself, so the way obedience is the way. The truth don't need excuses. Only lies need excuses. The truth shall make you free. That is Jesus, and whom the Son set free is free indeed. He shall make you free. If you know him, you shall know Jesus, and Jesus shall make you free. It ain't over. It ain't over. It ain't over. He still is who he is, and some things is in store according to the covenant or those promises. I just bless his name this morning.
The announcements for this week: midweek service Wednesday, 7 p.m. Saturday morning prayer, 6:30 a.m. Youth Sunday school next Sunday at 8:30. The 2024 anniversary luncheon payment should be Zelle to the church's email address with memo anniversary luncheon. Any anniversary offerings can be Zelle to Cant the business email. In the memo, put anniversary offering. Upcoming September birthdays: Mrs. Leela Walker, September 16th. September 18th, Mrs. Mom Costello Miller. September 21st, Mrs. Melissa Johnson. And September 25th, Mrs. Mom Benora Thompson. Happy anniversary, Reverend Gabriel and LaShonda Walker, 8 years. This week's Bible reading: Monday, Galatians chapter 6. Tuesday through Friday, Zechariah chapter 1 through 4. Floors today, Mr. Jimmy Craig and Braden Young. Next Sunday, Mr. Kenny Thompson and Jordan Lewis. Cleaning schedule, September 14th, Mrs. D. Jeffries. September 21st, Mrs. Evelyn Holloman. Prayer lifts, Reverend Randy and Jaquita Smith. Toshi, my Mary and family, Deacon Clegan Reed, and the regular prayer list. Hospitality, today only, donuts, $1. Get them while they're hot. The next up will be Pastor Howlett.
Good morning, everyone. With hospitality, we're going to help you out. What's happened is Nadine is out sick, and I don't know if she got that word in late, so this would have been her Sunday to cook. Sister Hospitality, just get the donuts away. But don't y'all take six. Yeah, look around, see how many people are in here. Everybody got to get a donut, okay?
No place to go.
Yeah, take one donut. Amen. Happy birthday to our son. I missed you last week. I gotta get your card, okay? So I'm looking around. We don't have a visitor. We have a friend that's here. So to my brother. Okay. And are there any other visitors? Hold up, my daughter. I'm going to ask Patrice to stand, if she will. This is our daughter from back in the day. This is Richard's only baby girl. We are so glad to have you with us this morning. You look beautiful. We're glad to see you. Know that besides me, we are holding you up. We are holding up your family, your siblings, and Deacon Reed and his siblings. Amen. We are tentatively looking to do Richard's life celebration in October on the 12th, so we'll be reaching out to see the things that we need to take care of. Amen. We're going to prepare to lift our morning offering. As I said, Nadine's out sick. I think Lisa called me. She's not feeling well. So let's just, those things are going around. Be careful with all of this heat. If you're watching us via internet, it is hot in Southern California right now. Make sure you get plenty of fluids in you. You also have to balance it with some salt, okay? That keep yourself balanced. So at this time, we're going to prepare to lift our morning offering. Then I'm going to come with the word, and by the grace of God, because it's hot. And I know this might be the only cool spot some of you have. I won't be long. Amen. Play before I come up. And I didn't even know my daughter Patrice was going to be here. Is my song in tribute to Lord is so real. I know he's real. I know he is. I know he is. Yes, he's real. I know he's real. I know he's real. He's real, real, real. Woo. Jesus is real, I know. Speaking with the confidence that Reverend Walker got up with, I know he's real. I had a nephew, one of my nephews was trying to think they were trying to be deep with me. Yeah, I'm not a religious person. I said, I ain't either. And he said, yeah, I consider myself a spiritual person. So he was trying to, you know, like diss Jesus. And this is what I told him, little Charles. I said, son, I am so sure about this that I know about, I ain't even gonna argue with you. I said, I ain't even gonna try to change your mind because I'm so sure about who Jesus is.
ain't got to argue with you. I ain't even got to convince you. And then I told him, because the word said every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. I said, so whether you do it now or if you do it later, you're going to acknowledge that he is Lord. Oh, that's going to be a great day, isn't it? Yeah. And all the folks that are trying to be like all staunch, we get around glory strong. Everybody going to be at the black. Oh, my goodness. I know he's real now. Oh, Jesus, I hope he ain't going to tell you, yeah, it's a little late. But anyway, as Bridget was praying, all we have to do is believe. He made it simple. He said, y'all can't keep that law to save y'all souls. I don't know what's wrong with you. I'm going to make it easy for you. If you believe on my son, you're going to have eternal life. He said, that's it. In fact, he said, your eternal life begins when you just believe. I think all of us should take a stroll to the cross every now and then. You know what? Throughout all of your saved living, every now and then, just take a little stroll down to the cross. Go on back there and see what he did for you. It'll encourage your heart. It'll make you know you can go on if you go back and look at that cross. Oh, bless his name. Now I'm going to fix this like this here, so he ain't going to have no shame, and my husband ain't got to worry about y'all seeing his stuff. There we go. Okay, amen. I put it on this side. There we go. Okie dokie. Amen. So as I told you, I won't be long this morning. I'm still in this thing. And as Rem was saying, I guess other ministers are understanding too. I'm still in this thing of us, of our suffering and our tests and our trials, because, beloved, that if you're not in it now, you're going to be in it. If you just got out, there's going to be another one, because there is a purpose for all of these things in our lives. No, we don't like it. Who likes to suffer? Who wants to be tested and tried? No one does. Can't we just skip on down this righteous trail and just have some balloons in our hands and just be going? Can't we do like Linus on that thing? Yeah, can't we just do that? But God has a purpose. He has purpose in every part of our lives. He has purpose. And so as some of you were saying last week, I dealt with that thing about how do we do this in this, the suffering and our obedience, how we have to shout it out. Today I'm going back Old Testament, because I want to take a look at this thing about these gains we get when we are gleaning. There are gains, beloved, when you are gleaning. There are gains when you are gleaning. And I don't want the devil to make you think what you go through is nothing. You are gaining something. Sometimes you don't even see it till you get way up the road and you're stable when you used to be crazy. That's because there was some gain in your gleaning. And I have to go to Ruth, our gleaning sister, who knew what she had to do. So I'm going to ask now if you would stand to your feet. And Reverend Marquis Clark is going to read. She's going to read the entirety of verse 15 and through 16.
And when she was risen up to glean, Boaz commanded his young men, saying, let her glean even among the sheaves, and reproach her not, and let fall also some of the handfuls of purpose for her. and leave them, that she may glean them and rebuke her not.
Gleaning, the act of a person who gleans, finds, or acquires by gleaning, to collect gradually and bit by bit. Father, we thank you this morning that you have laid out in your word all the things that we need to live right and to make it in this life. So whenever our life on this part of our journey ends, we will just step on into the fore life, the mirror life, the upcoming life that we have. We thank you today. I ask that you would grant understanding in your word, that you will let it impact hearts and minds, that when it's all said and done, Lord, Spirit of God, will you bring this back to our remembrance? You give us things to stand on. Let us hold on to these. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. I'm going to ask if you will give me a little leeway with this passage of scripture, because I want to set this up so that we'll understand that the Spirit is just not talking about Ruth. Because God's Spirit has connected the Old Testament and the New Testament and brought all of these examples so that we will be able to make it in this life. Let me set this up so that you will understand the gains that are in our gleaning. And I have those written in the program, the cleansing, the clarity, the commissioning, and the crowning. But I don't even think I'm going to get to that today, Sister LaQuinta, because I got to deal with what I'm dealing with. I like the Word of God. Because if you take time with it, man, it will reveal things to you that you will have never even thought or seen. So I'm dealing with our suffering and the purpose of our suffering, that a lot of times when we're in it, we don't see it. We don't know if God's mad at us, if this is payback for that last thing we did. We don't understand it. Is this from my youth? Yeah, I was hating somebody. Yeah, we don't have a clue sometimes. And it could be all those things. I don't know. But I know that there is a gain when we glean spiritually. The first thing that catches my attention is in this. And verse 15, it says, and when she was risen. Now, I'm beginning at the point where you're already in something. You've been in it. Sometimes we're in trouble for a long time. It's just like, yeah, I don't know, maybe this is going to be the rest of my life. I was suffering one time when I was young in the Lord. And I had concluded, Miss Evie, that the rest of my life was going to be suffering. Because I didn't see when I was getting out. I was just miserable. I know I didn't want to be unsaved, but I was like, so this is it. This is what I got saved for. I'm going to just be miserable the rest of my life. And I see some heads nodding, so I'm going to take it. Some of y'all been there too. I'm going to just be miserable. I'm going to be saved and miserable. I know. They don't even go together, do they? But it says here, talking about Ruth, and when she was risen up. Risen means when she got up. Because wherever you're at, Reverend Randy, eventually you're going to have to decide to get up. Oh, you can't wallow in it forever. She decided to get on up. I don't care how long you've been there, how much it hurts, eventually you got to decide, I'm getting up. Yeah, right. Yeah. Tell the devil, I'm getting up. Yeah. So it says when she was risen up, she got up. Woo! Because Jesus got up, we can get up. She made the first move. She got up. And Boaz in this story is a type of Christ, a redeemer, kinsman. And I'm looking at Ruth as the church, as the beloved, as the saints of the Most High God. Beloved, sometimes you have to make a decision to just get up. Get up. God's waiting on you. You're not waiting on Him. He's waiting on us. When she was risen up to finally start picking up the pieces of whatever she was in, that's when the kinsman redeemer told them what to do. When she got up, our first step in spiritual recovery is getting up. Let me tell you, nothing changes until we decide to get up. Order came to her when she got up. Am I right, Brother Jimmy? You got to make a decision. Look, this is it. I'm done with this. You got to make a decision to get up. Oh, man, I don't want to get personal in my own life. And I know some of y'all saying, well, don't do it then. Okay. My heart was hurt about something. And the history of things in your mind. Right. I want you to get this. Because sometimes it's a history of stuff, of hurts in your mind. And the history of it will throw you down, Reverend Walker. You'll think you're going well, and here comes the history. Yeah. To throw you down again. Yeah. I had to finally, Reverend, say, I am tired of wallowing in the floor over this same thing. Yes. Over and over and over again, because the devil kept bringing it up. Yes. And every time he brought it up, I went down. Yes. I got tired of that. Yes. Yeah. After a while, you got to get up. Because nothing will change until we get up. Look what happened. Order came to Ruth when she got up. When she decided enough is enough. Now, I don't know where you're at in your life today. Eventually, some of you, whether you're young or old, you have to make a decision. Look, enough is enough. There are times I had to tell the devil, this is enough of this. You done did too much. You done went on too long with this foolishness. Yes. Ruth finally said, this is enough of this. I'm done with this. When she got up, that's when things start changing for her. And so the kinsman redeemer says, now let her gather among the heaps. I like this. This heap means let her gather something from the leftovers. Woo! Y'all walk with me, walk with me, walk with me. Yes. See, gleaning is tedious and it's hard work. You're really looking for leftovers among nothing. So you have to have intention to the details about what you are gathering. So Ruth began to glean. And let me tell all of us in here, everyone in here, we have leftovers in our lives. The sheaves were bundled up in different spaces in the field. Everyone in here has leftovers in your life. It can be pain from something, shame from something you did or that was done to you.
There can be intense hurt, broken promises. You believe someone and they took advantage of your trust in them. So you feel betrayed. Some of you may be disillusioned. You ain't have any apathy about nothing. You're apathetic. Sorrow can come in our lives. There can be emotional wounding. And some of these things take the hand of God to get over. There's mental anguish from your past. Forget that, from your present. Wait a minute, from your future. Just all kind of stuff going on in your head. So then you have this sense of loss and this sense of dread, this lack of purpose and self. See, we all have these bundles laying in our fields. Stuff. All kind of situations. But when we make up in our minds to get up and to rise up, that is when our gathering becomes full of purpose. When you decide to get up with Jesus, then your gathering will become full of purpose. So he told them, let her gather them up. You know how we gather up? We gather stuff up in prayer. Sometimes all you can do is take it to God. I don't know what else to tell you. I'll tell you some of this stuff. Look, everyone in here has gone through something. And no one really has the answer. But let me tell you, all you can do, sometimes just gather that stuff up and take it to God in prayer. You don't know the answer. You don't know how to work it out. Let God have it. The difficult things in your life, give it over to God. Why do you keep trying to solve it? This is what gets me. It ain't even smart people trying to solve stuff. You know you barely got out of school. You better take that stuff to God in prayer. But see, we will get stuck in our own mind, Kristen. We'll be stuck up there. If I do this, when you ready to do this? Oh, I'm going to do that. What am I going to do that? No one has hired you to do one of them games the kids play. You ain't got hired for that. Get out your head with all that. Get out of your head doing all of that. You don't know what you're doing. You just up there. Get out of it. I don't have any teenage sons, but I hear when these young kids is on these games with each other, even up in here, they got adult language going on. And it ain't saved adult language. It's the adult language all folks used to use. When they used to say, I'm gonna whoop y'all, get the... That's what I heard. I ain't on the game of things, so I have no clue about it. They have their own conversation. Can I tell on you for a second, Reverend Son? You saying no? Okay. My Reverend, he was young, which I thought it was so unusual, and his cousin was there, LaTanya. They didn't know I drove on up in the garage. And I'm standing at the door listening. So they was having a cuss fest going on. They were trying to see who could cuss each other out. I mean, they was just throwing all kind of words, just like back. They had a cuss fest going. I'm just standing at the door listening. I was shocked because I would have thought it would have been finest because I already heard him. But it wasn't him. It was Gabriel and Tanya. I couldn't believe it. Finest was just sitting there listening. They was going back and forth. experiment with being grown when we're not. You like to think you have it under control, and you don't. You want to believe, we want to believe we can figure everything out, and we can't. You got to learn how to pick stuff up. Ruth began to gather these things up. So when we're gathering, we gather it up in prayer. We take it to the Father. And let me tell you something. Our Lord is skilled with dealing with leftovers. He knows how to deal with leftovers. When he fed the 5,000, what did he tell them? Pick up every fragment. Woo! Pick it all up. Don't leave nothing. Gather up the fragments. What we think is detrimental, the Lord is saying, gather up those fragments. Watch what I do with it. Go ahead and glean it. Get them, gather them up. You think it's nothing. You think it was to your heart. Gather it up. And watch what I do with it. Oh, he takes broken lives all the time. Bring those fragments to me. And watch what I do with it. Many of us have been cleansed from tormenting things of our past because we gathered it up. It ain't because we talked ourselves over it. It's because we realize, Lord, if you don't help me, I don't know if I'm going to ever get over this. And we trusted him enough to take it to him in prayer. And by and by, Deacon Finest, he freed us. All of us in here suffered something by our own means or by at the hands of someone else. Everyone in here has been through something that was unjust. But I'm so glad, God, like, I got you in this field now. I want you to gather up this stuff. Because I do wonders with leftovers. Oh, he does. Jesus does wonders with the broken pieces of our lives. Some of us are beyond broken. We're shattered. But even that, he's like, I can handle shattered. Whatever you bring to me, I got it. I can handle it. And I like this as we keep reading this. And he told them, and then, look how the Lord is. Saints, when we are going through things, he protects us. Look what he tells them. He said, don't reproach her. Don't say nothing to her. Don't shame her. Don't rebuke her. She's where I want her at. Let her gather. Some of that stuff, it has to be just his ability to bring, to make everything work out for good. Because somehow, some things we don't know how we're still standing. I'm telling you the truth. We don't know why some stuff didn't drive us crazy. This young 14-year-old child who took a gun to school and started shooting up folks. That would have been some of us. They wanted to say, somebody said it was a deranged young, the child is 14. I'm not condoning that at all. But somewhere somebody wasn't doing what they were supposed to be doing. First of all, don't buy them a gun. You know, now if your child is crazy, now, some of y'all going to have to be honest in here. If you know your child is crazy, don't go buy him a gun. You already know he's crazy. He might shoot you with it. I'm just saying. You might not want to get him one. Give him some karate lessons. You know, taekwondo, boxing, something. But don't give him a gun. Don't give him a knife.
Well, give our girls, y'all can have some tasers, but you know, let's keep this stuff right. Because now, as we see, they're starting to blame these parents for what their children is doing. Oh boy, for all the parents who want to blame everybody else, the law is starting to say, nope, this one's on you. Oh my, 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 my. Anyway, I'm going to keep moving on with this. So he said, he tells them, don't you rebuke her, don't shame her while she is in this process of gathering. And then he says, let fall also some of the handfuls of purpose for her. And I want y'all to highlight that if you can in your program, these handfuls of purpose. This gleaning thing that God gives us in our lives. And I think I dealt with this with the women's retreat. If you can, just cup your hands. And I want you to look in your hands. And with your imagination, I want you to see all the pain you've been through, all the hurt, all the disillusionment, all the heartache, all the suffering, all the misunderstanding, all the misguided trust, all of those who messed up what you believed about them. And God says, in that handful, he has purpose. If you let him have it, he says, I got purpose in there. I know all you see is pain right now, but I have purpose. He says, let her get all of these handfuls of purpose. So all of that stuff laying on our field, when we look at it, we start gathering it up. God says, I know what it looks like to you, but I got some purpose there. Oh, I bless his name. I'm telling y'all, I would not be standing where I am at today had not Raquel God saw purpose in my pain. There is purpose in your pain. There is purpose in your pain. Let her have these handfuls of purpose. Look, and this is what he does. He remembers our sins no more. Here he tells them, leave some of that stuff there. Sometimes we need to walk through. Last week I said, you have to overcome by your testimony. Sometimes we need to walk through the field of our sufferings. Yeah. And look to the left and look to the right. Look at all, almost dry bones of your sufferings. Look all around you. And then I want you to look at yourself and see how God brought you out of all of that field of debris. You know, when a plane crashes, they say it has a debris field. Some of us have crashed so many times. We got this extended debris field all around us because we hit the ground so hard with our stubbornness, our foolishness, our dependence on ourselves. Yes. If God can shake anything from you today, I want him to shake from you that you are self-sufficient and you can work everything out. You can't in this life. Right. You need God. Right. We need God. Yes. You can't work this out by yourself. Yes. We need God. Some of this stuff is too heavy for us. Yes, yes, yes. You can't carry that load. Yes, right, right, right. So that thing of being yoked with Christ, yes, he gets under the load. Yes, right. He's like, you just walk beside me. I got this. I can't imagine how God
could let his son take everything. Again, I want y'all to think about all of your disappointments, your hurt, your pain, how God let his son carry all of that to the cross. I don't know how he got up under the weight of me. Forget you. How did he get up under the weight of me and take that to the cross so that now I can walk around and I'm better? And I'm wiser, and I'm stronger, Reverend Randy. I don't despise the chastening of the Lord. And I've learned now not to faint when I get rebuked. I know he just want to help me. He ain't trying to hurt me. He like, when I correct you, don't be holding your head down. Get on up. That's what a loving father does. He corrects his children. In fact, he goes as far as say, if I don't correct you, you a bastard.
Right, exactly.
And you like, fat bastard. You a bastard. Y'all know I had to go to a movie. I'm sorry. He said, you're a bastard and not a son.
That's right.
He wants us to come to him. God has already paid the price for every one of us to be right. Listen, no one in here has to walk around with the weight of their life.
No, right. That's true.
The weight of our life is heavy. And I ain't talking about the weight on our bodies. Sometimes the weight on our bodies is a reflection of the weight on our life. Let fall also some of the handfuls of purpose for her. Ruth had to get down in that thing and pull out the good. And not only that, he told them and leave them. And let her keep gleaning. Let her keep finding my purpose in everything she has gone through. And then he adds a final statement, and don't rebuke her either. Don't rebuke her. When we were reading Psalms 105 in Bible study, and where it says, touch not my anointed, and I said a lot of times people think that's the servant of God, the messenger of God. But no, it's the people of God, it's the saints. That's what the Lord tells the devil. Don't touch my people. I don't care what they're going through. Yeah, they said some crazy stuff. They're crazy. Some of us are very cray-cray. It's like, I know God be like, is they still saying that kind of stuff? I thought I delivered you from that last time. You know, it's still in your mind. Okay, let's walk with this again. But he's like, let her glean it. Beloved, today, if anything, I want you to understand, when you are in something painful, testing, trial, whatever it is, you have to get yourself up and start trying to see, Lord, what do you need me to get out of this? See, some of us who have been traveling with the Lord for a bit, we do that with anything. Okay, Lord, what do I need to see? It ain't even got anything deep. After a while, your habit is, okay, Jesus, what do I need to see about this? What's off about this? We got in the habit of going to the Lord saying, okay, I don't know what's wrong, but you got to show me. Where am I off at? I ain't even trying to see what somebody else is doing. I know. I got enough. I got enough on my hands. I'm praying for you, but I'm really praying for me. We need to get to where that's what we do. We get up and we keep looking for him in everything we are in. Told you I wasn't going to be long. I'm going to get ready to close. Last week I talked about shout it out. But I want to, this came to me. I want to talk about the wash cycle. Okay. Yeah. Now, prayerfully, you've been trained on how to wash clothes. So, some of you parents, even if it's your son, make sure they know how to wash their clothes. You don't put everything in the same load. they remember, I took my sons downstairs in our basement in Rockford. I said, this is how you separate your clothes. You got your dark clothes, your white clothes, and your in-between clothes. Your dark clothes, you put them in cold water. White clothes, you put them in hot water. In-between clothes, put them in warm water. Yeah, I told them, there ain't no guarantee somebody gonna marry you. But thank God they got married. But, you know, in case they had to be out there on their own, I didn't want to run up on them and they got nasty clothes on and they stink. And I'd be like, Lord, it's an embarrassment to a parent. You'd be like, I did not train that child to be like that. But anyway, the wash cycle. And I was looking at my washing machine that we have at our home. And I looked at all the different cycles on the washing machine. There's a normal cycle. That's just your everyday cleansing. Yeah, this your regular stuff. Oh man, did I put my finger up at that driver again? Yeah, that's your normal everyday cleansing. Then I have a heavy duty cycle. The heavy duty cycle lasts, washes an hour just washing. Y'all know some of y'all got heavy duty stuff and you wondering why the cycle keep going. Because what's in your life is heavy duty. So it gotta keep washing and washing and for a whole hour. It doesn't even rinse, it just washes. I go in there thinking, is it time for the fabric? Nope, it's still washing. Heavy duty. Sometimes we have heavy duty trials. God, like I've been trying to talk to you. Then I have a cycle that's called bedding. Now, what I have found out with the bedding, it puts lots of water in the washing machine. It'd be full of water. I'd be like, ain't even that much stuff in there. Sometimes that washing of water by the word, it seems like it's continual and all going. It seems like, oh man, it's filling up again. Don't I get a rinse? No. That's when he keeps pouring his word and pouring his word and pouring his word so we can get it. Then I got one that's called deep wash. Oh, well, I'm gonna get the delegate. But you see what y'all wanna do? Hey, where the delegate one at? Everybody sitting here with, where the delegate cycle? Now the deep wash isn't as long as the heavy duty cycle, but the deep wash is agitated more. It'd be twisting them clothes and man, it'd be like, I'm gonna get this dirt out. It's coming up out of here. It ain't gonna take me long to do it. I'm gonna get this dirt out. And of course, we have a white cycle. When you turn it on that cycle, it automatically go to hot water. You ain't getting nothing cool, no lukewarm. I'm gonna burn you up till you get this right. Then on the other side is delicates. Just a little gentle. Now, like it just barely moving. Now, most of y'all, because I know y'all well, y'all are not delicate cycle people. Just, there are a few of y'all might be just delicate. The machine barely moving, Reverend. It'd just be like, you be wondering yourself, is the clothes gonna get clean? Can they get clean on that cycle? I actually put my delicate in the next cycle because I know it's going to
wash them a little more, and that's permanent press. Permanent press is, it'll clean it, but it's gonna clean it so that it doesn't destroy the form of the thing. All of these cycles, and we need them at all different times in our lives. But through all these cycles, God is getting us to where we can stand before Him clean and understand His purpose in our lives. That's what He is. He wants all of us to come out of our fields with these handfuls of understanding. Let's stand to our feet. Last week, I told you about Shout It Out. I'm going to just give you another acronym this week. And the word is, it's going to correlate a little bit with shout, but it's spot. Because this is what God is doing. He wants us to be without spot or blemish or any such thing. So when we are in our fields gleaning, we have to remember to stand, to pray, to be obedient, and to trust. And that is spot. Stand, pray, be obedient, and trust. I don't know if anyone wants to come to the altar or needs to, but we're going to have the altar open at this time while we play some soft music. If anyone wants to come forward, I want my daughter Patrice to come. If you don't mind, I just want to anoint you, okay?
Falling in love with Jesus.
And Reverend Howlett has been in a lot of pain.
Falling in love.
If he would come, and if some of the ministers could pray over him.
Some was the best thing I've ever done. Oh yes, oh yes, oh yes. Falling in love.
You want to come to the altar? The altar is open.
Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus was the best thing I've ever done. In His arms I feel protected. In these arms, never disconnected. No, no. In these arms, I feel protected. There's no place I'd rather be. Can you sing with me this evening? Can I hear you sing it? Sing it for me tonight. Come on, say it.
Falling in love,
hey, yeah,
with Jesus.
Oh, sing it.
Falling in love.
Come on, can you stand up and sing with me tonight?
Falling in love with Jesus.
With Jesus. What's the best thing? What's the best thing I've ever done? In His arms, I'd be protected. Sing it with me tonight, come on.
In His arms, I feel protected. In His arms,
never disconnected,
never disconnected. In His arms, I feel protected. There's no place I'd rather be.
Yeah. Amen. Amen. Touch their bodies. Yeah. Amen. Glean this week, beloved. Gather and get your pans full of purpose. Amen. We're the Smiths. Give each other love. Get one donut. And we'll see you on Wednesday.